Hey Pfingsters, and welcome to today's video where I want to show you the difference between, like, why did Python creators choose string.join of a list instead over list.join of a string? Okay, so this is a very common question. Actually, I have asked it myself. So say you want to join, you have a list of some values, say a list of strings A, B, and C, and you want to join them, then to join them together to get the string ABC. So you want to have the concatenation of all the elements, and you would use this delimiter string, in this case the empty string, as the string on which you call the join function, and now you pass the iterable. So it's kind of counterintuitive. You would expect that you have a list and you want to join together the list, so you intuitively you will just call list.join the string, and the string as a delimiter. So basically, intuitively, I would do something like this: list.join, and then you simply pass the delimiter. So you can either pass nothing, then you would like join the empty string. So this could be the default argument, and then you can also have a delimiter string, which, for example, this minus, and then this would join together the element. But then, of course, if you execute this, then the first one works, ABC, it joins together the three strings in your list of strings, and the second one tells me that list object has no attribute join. Okay, so this is, of course, this is not possible. This is possible. So the intuitive way doesn't seem to work. Why is that? So what is the reason for this? And in the last hour or so, I have tried to find an answer to this, and I came up with three lines of thinking. So I read the communication between Guido van Rossum and the other Python creators, who discussed why they prefer this method. So using the delimiter string on which they call the function, and then joining together the iterable you pass over this one, where you call it the join function on the list object itself. And so one, like, the most important argument, I guess, is that you can pass anything here. So you can pass any iterable into the join function. You can even do something like this. So you can use a generator expression, for example, x for x in list if x not, no, if x not ESO is unequal to a. Okay, so you can do something like this. So you can use list comprehension. You take all the elements in the list, but only if the element is not a. Okay, so you can, this, the return value of this is a generator. It's not even a list. So you can pass, you can join generator expressions, you can join lists, you can join tuples, you can join sets. And therefore, if you would have this method, the list.join function, then you would also have to implement, say, a set.join function on the minus. You would also have to implement the, like, generator expression. It's not even, I don't even know how this could be done, actually. Because generator expression, like an iterator, this is, an iterator is only an interface, it's not even a class, so therefore it's even, I think it's impossible to implement the join function in a very general way, so that is valid to all iterators, like lists and tuples and strings, yeah. And so I mean, you can either have, the Python creators had this option of using, like, one join method for all, so using the string.join method, and this works on all iterables, so you pass any iterable into it, but you have only one implementation of the join function, or you have hundreds of implementations for all iterators that are possible. And then, in this case, you need to require that the creator of the new iterator, so if you create your own iterator class, you can do this, you can simply implement the iter method in your object. So, for example, say you have a class X, and now you say def iter and so on. So then you can implement this yourself, and you can override the default iterator method, and then in this case your method would allow to iter, so your class, so people can iterate over LM over your class, basically, yeah. So you can call something later for x in x. Okay, so this would be possible because your class X has implemented the iterator interface. So therefore, you would need to require. So if you would allow the join method over each iterator, then everybody must implement the join function as well. So you would have needed to require something like this. Okay. So because each iterator must be able to join together the elements in the iterator. So this is like the requirement, and therefore everyone needs to implement the join method also. And this is a bit strange, yeah, to do this. And then, so this is like one argument. The second argument is explicit is better than implicit. What does this mean? So if you open your Python shell, like import, and you type in import this, then you get the Zen of Python, and here the second statement actually is explicit is better than implicit. So what do they mean? They mean that you should always try to make things explicit. So you should not have implicit type conversions, for example, if possible. But the join method, so if you try to join the elements in, say, a list 1, 2, 3, so say you have an integer list and now you try to join these elements. What does it even mean? Yeah, because now, so of course Python will throw an error because it expects string values and it finds integer values. And the reason is that there's no like best way of interpreting the join method. So if you have the join method on a list of integers, then you can either sum them up or you can have the string representation of these integers. Then you would have the result 1, 2, 3. Yeah, if you sum them up, then you would have the result 6. But you can also do other things, like why summing them up? Why not averaging them or anything? And so if you basically created the join method if you implemented the join method on an arbitrary iterable, so you have like this iterable.join semantic, then even if the iterable is a list of integers, for example, not a list of strings, then it would need to convert the integers to strings. Or if you have arbitrary complicated objects, like an iterable of arbitrary complicated objects, then it would need to implicitly convert each object to the string representation of this object. And this is not obvious for the coder. This can lead to really confusing output. Because some objects, so for example, if you have a list of iterables, again, then the output is really strange. I mean, the string representation is not always meaningful. And then if you concatenate these unmeaningful string representation, this also doesn't make a lot of sense. So if you would allow it, so like the takeaway is if you would allow to the string, the join function to work on any iterable, so you can call iterable.join and then you have the delimiter string, then you would need to do some implicit conversion. So because if the iterable contains a list of objects, you need to convert the objects to strings so that you can convert them. But this is not obvious, yeah? For like the semantics are not obvious, because a list of integers joining them together semantically, I would say it's not a obvious thing to sum them together. So you can also simply, if you have two lists of integers, then you would just concatenate these lists. This would be the intuitive thing of joining them, actually. Then the third argument, arguments are brought, like I got from a conversation. Actually, it was proposed. So I will just give you the conversation. So in the year 1999, you see, it's like more than 20 years ago. A Python coder called Skip Montanaro, which is also one of the Python's fathers, he said that it occurred to me just a few minutes after sending the previous message that it might make sense to make string.join a method for lists and tuples. Okay, so you can do something like this. You can have a list of integers and then you call join. Actually, this is so it was even proposed to use this. And then David, who is also one creator of Python, replied that it has some problems if you have a list of integers instead of list of strings, okay? Because of this problem. Then what does it mean? I mean, he spoke about the generalization of the join method, which is the reduce function, which is even more confusing for beginners. So, but this would be the natural conclusion, if you have the join function on lists, then you would have to call it reduce, kind of, yeah, because it's like in Python already had the reduce function, and reduce function means, yeah, you reduce an iterable to a smaller iterable, basically. So joining them together, it would semantically be the same as the reduce function. So then, for example, you would have something like this. You have a list of integers, you reduce them, which means in this case, you add them together. But what is the default behavior for general objects? It's not, sometimes it's string concatenation, sometimes it's the plus operator, so like the add operation of an object. So it's not consistent and it would lead to confusion. And so this was what David answered to this, but then Guido van Rossum, the like benevolent dictator for life in Python, one of the first creator basically of Python, he said he brought three arguments. So, and let's see the arguments, maybe make a bit smaller. So the first argument, I will just read it aloud. Note that this is not as powerful as string.join. So this was what this Skip Montanaro wrote using the list.join function. And he said it's not as powerful as string.join because the latter works on any sequence, not just on list on tuples. Okay, list of and tuples. So he said, actually, yeah, it works on iterable. The string.join method works on any iterable, so you can pass any iterable into the function. But the list.join, it's only specific for lists by definition. Otherwise, and then you need to have a join function on strings, on tuples, on all the other iterables, which is really a pain to implement this. So this was the first argument brought by Guido van Rossum. The second one is, he said, I also find it slightly objectionable that this is a general list method, but only works if the list contains only strings. So this was the argument we have also brought, yeah, that we have, if you have a list of integers, then it will throw an error, yeah. And now if you would, so like this, yeah, so it expects a string instance, but it finds an integer. So to be explicit, it throws the error for all list of objects if the objects are not strings. Okay, so it allows only list of strings as an argument. So it checks the argument and allows it. Yeah, but if you have implemented it as a list method, then this would be valid. It would be a valid method for all lists, no matter the elements in the list. So even if the list contains one integer, like here, say we have this one, yeah? So even if it contains only a single integer or a single non-string element, it will throw this error. So so Guido said that if you would have done this, so if you have a list.join method, but then it works only, so then it gives you the impression that it's a general list method, but then it doesn't work on most lists. It doesn't work on all the list of integers and so on. So because it throws the error to ensure that we have the explicit method and not the implicit one. So this is kind of, it's not intuitive, and it's also, it's wasteful. Yeah, because you have a method, a general method, but that's actually very specific, that only works for specific use cases. And in all the other cases, it will throw an error. But on the other hand, the method will always work on a string. Okay, so if we have it as a string method, string.join, then it will always work. It will throw an error if you pass the wrong type of data into it, but of course this is as any other method, yeah. So if you give the wrong type of argument, then of course it will throw an error as any other method also. But it's not like, it gives not the impression that it's generalizable, that it's general applicable. And then he even proposed like a third argument. He said perhaps join could be a built-in function. And this is actually, I think, so if you would ask me, I predict that in future versions of Python, they may use the join function as a built-in function based on this comment. I mean, this comment is old, it's from 1999, but I think this makes a lot of sense. of course, it came from the creator of Python, so it better had to make a lot of sense. But I mean, as you know, you have the print function as a built-in function, the string method is a built-in function. So there are many built-in functions that actually work like without importing them. They are not object specific. And I think in this case, it also doesn't make a lot of sense to make it string specific, this join method. So it is, it would be like, it's not a method that manipulates a string or so. Okay, so usually if you have object-oriented thinking, then each object has a method. And the method should manipulate the object. This is the purpose. It should either manipulate the object or return a new one, yeah? But if you have pure functionality, then it should not implement it, should not be implemented on the object level. It should be implemented on the class level or even on a higher level. So it's like it's more a functional approach. The join method is actually not an object method. It should not be an object method because it doesn't manipulate the object. It is more a functionality type of it's a function. Yeah. So it should be some utility function like a conversion function or so. So it takes some arguments. So it should actually be the join function. So I would say the most intuitive approach for beginners would be to, you have the function, you join an iterable and delimiter, for example, yeah? And so this should be the implementation of the join method, okay? So you have the definition of join, takes an iterable, takes a delimiter, and now it's like, you know how it works. Now you can even call return delimiter.join on the iterable. So you could do something like this, yeah? But this would make a lot of sense, I think, this implementation of the join function, because the idea of the join function is more a functional thing, yeah. So it provides a certain functionality, given some input arguments. So it transforms input arguments to output arguments, and it is not specific to a certain object like a string or delimiter object. It's not. It doesn't manipulate the object itself. So in pure object-oriented thinking, I'd say that it's a bit mismatched to the approach we have currently. And also this was, of course, what Guido van Rossum proposed. So I think we may see something like this in future versions of Python. But today in Python 3.8, even the join method is not a built-in function. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed the small discussion about the most Pythonic way of doing something. If you're interested in learning more, check out my email list where I release a lot of free Python content. You can check blog.fingster.com/subscribe, and I will also give a link in the description below. So everything is free. You get a lot of free content. So check out my email list and see you in the next video. Bye.